Kanche. Welcome. Bienvenue à Rendez-vous Batoche.
I hope that you won't be shy. This is a wonderful opportunity for the two communities to talk together and share what it means to be Métis and Francophone and the challenges that that represents. And the idea is to be honest. I hope we won't fall into sort of platitudes and think that we have to be politically correct, but I hope that we all understand that we want to be respectful and constructive and be honest at the same time. So I think I've said everything I needed to say. This is a special occasion, and I hope that we'll have a useful, stimulating, and respectful conversation. So as I said, we have two co-facilitators, Marilyn Poitras and Francine Proulx-Kenzle, and I'll present them briefly to each of you, to all of you, and then Francine and Marilyn are going to present briefly the people who are seated around the table, and then we'll start with our roundtable discussion. Marilyn Poitras is originally from Indian Head. Marilyn is Métis, Saskatchewan born and raised. She is a constitutional lawyer with an expertise in Aboriginal law and cultural relations. She teaches and has designed programs in Nunavut and Saskatchewan around the Indigenous communities' identified interests, needs, and priorities. Marilyn's institutional education includes a law degree from the University of Saskatchewan and a master's in law from Harvard Law School. However, her real lessons come from her work with Indigenous people across Canada, ancient knowledge keepers, social entrepreneurs, and those close to her. Marilyn. Thank you, Marilyn, for agreeing to facilitate the roundtable. Francine Proulx-Kenzle est native de Rimouski, Québec. Francine est déménagée avec sa famille dans la région de Prince-Albert à l'âge de 11 ans. Elle a habité à Prince-Albert, Albertville, Meat Park, Calgary et maintenant Regina. Elle a été administratrice rurale pour la RM of, excusez-moi, of Garden River, aviseur aux municipalités pour le gouvernement provincial, directrice adjointe à l'Assemblée communautaire fransaskoise et maintenant directrice adjointe responsable pour les relations communautaires à l'Institut français. Francine est très impliquée dans la communauté fransaskoise et a siégé comme élue à l'Assemblée communautaire fransaskoise, le conseil de l'école fransaskoise de Prince-Albert et le conseil général des écoles fransaskoises. Merci Francine d'avoir accepté, toi aussi, de faciliter cette table ronde aujourd'hui. Donc je vais vous... So I'm going to hand things over now to Marilyn and Francine, who will introduce our special guests, and then we'll start our roundtable. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to cold Saskatchewan in the middle of August. And this is a character building exercise. And so for those of you with only one personality, I promise you'll leave with at least three by the time we last this wind out, okay? I'm very happy to be here. I was honored to be asked to help facilitate today, and we're going to start by some introductions of the panelists. In the true nature of Métis, we're being a little bit obstinate. It's actually a square table, it's not a round table, so I think that's just a representative of who we are and what we stand for. So we're going to start with Rita Bouvier. And if I could just get you to give a wave so people can see where you're sitting when you answer the question. Thank you, Rita. Rita Bouvier's roots are in the village of Ville La Crosse in northern Saskatchewan. She presently lives in Saskatoon and works at the Aboriginal Learning and Knowledge Centre at the University of Saskatchewan. She's well known in the Métis community for her contribution to various organizations such as the Northern Governance Task Force, Gabriel Dumont Institute of Native Studies and Applied Research, the Independent Oversight Committee on Métis Elections Saskatchewan, Iskwewak Achit Ewichit, I had a Cree lesson all the way up here yesterday, so I would say that properly. Women working together, formerly known as missing Aboriginal women, to name a few of the things that she's working on right now. So thank you, Rita, for agreeing to be here. Terry Boyer is the next person at the table, and Terry, formerly known as Gabriel Dumont, because he's role-played for and done some acting, and you met Terry last night. So just to refresh your memories about who he is, he lives in St. Oh, now I didn't practice my French on the way up here yesterday, so St. Laurent de Grandin, just north of Batoche, and happens to be his grandfather's river lot. Works for the provincial government as a social worker now for 37 years and also does some private contracting work. He's active in promoting the Métis culture through a variety of organizations such as Canadian Métis Heritage Corporation, Saskatchewan Métis Wagon Adventures, Métis Homeland Batoche Local 51, and Gabriel Dumont Institute. Welcome, Terry.
Bonjour tout le monde, je suis très contente, très heureuse d'être ici, un vrai honneur de participer à cette table ronde. Donc je vais continuer avec les présentations. C'est Madame Lucille Georget, c'est bon. Alors Lucille est née à Prince-Albert, elle a grandi dans la région de Dorémy, sauf pour une période de 2 ans où elle a habité à Torch River, qui est près de Nipawin. Lucille a récemment célébré son 40e anniversaire de mariage. Elle est retraitée depuis 2 ans du système de santé. Elle a été, entre autres, au service de l'hôpital de Waka pendant une 20aine d'années. Elle travaille présentement au centre communautaire fransaskoise de Dorémy comme agente de développement. Merci, Lucille.
Next, we have Simone Laliberté. Simone was born and educated in Beauval, Saskatchewan. She lived in Selkirk, Manitoba for 14 years of her adult life. And when she was in her 30s, she moved back to Beauval where she raised her children, worked, and contributed to her community. She's presently employed by Northern Village of Beauval as a coordinator of community reference panel, doing advocacy work around children and families in need of service. Thanks, Simone, for coming.
Maintenant, nous avons avec nous M. Benoit Perret, qui est né à La Plaine, un petit village entre Duck Lake et Rostern. Il aura 80 ans cette année. Un fermier à La Plaine jusqu'à l'âge de 36 ans. Il a retourné aux études plus tard à l'Université de Saskatchewan pour compléter son BA et son certificat en enseignement. Il a enseigné à Saint-Louis pour 21 ans et il est retraité depuis 89. Merci, M. Perret.
Now we've got a couple of youth on our panel as well, and I'd like to introduce to you Scott Langlois. Scott grew up in Prince Albert and is an active member of his community there. He works with several different children's groups and with senior citizens. He's a student at SunTep in Prince Albert, studying education. He's looking forward to his convocation next year and starting a career in Saskatchewan as a teacher. So welcome, Scott. Besides Scott, we have Susan McKenzie. She's a Red River Métis who grew up in La Ronge and is now residing in Rostern. With her experience in Aboriginal media, arts, and culture, Susan has contributed to various projects in Aboriginal Métis communities, including developing a youth program for crystal meth education, organizing the first Métis cultural festival in La Ronge, and she is currently employed as a coordinator at the Batoche National Historic Site, so she will be a familiar face to some of you. Thanks for coming, Susan. Next, we have Ed Bruce, if you want to just give a wave there, Mr. Bruce. Ed was born in Bellevue in 1933 and moved to Batoche when he was 25 years old. Some of you are madly doing math in your head. I wonder how old this guy is right now. He had a long, rewarding career working as a visitor activity supervisor at the Batoche National Historic Site in 1961, and there he met all cultures. In 1994, he retired from the park and moved to St. Louis. One of his passions is horses, competing in chuck wagon and chariot races and winning.
À côté de Monsieur Bruce, c'est Adèle. Adèle, une petite fille de Bellevue, qui est diplômée de l'école Saint-Isidore. Adèle travaille, elle aussi, comme guide au lieu national historique de Batoche. Adèle est une violoniste. On l'a entendue hier au spectacle. C'était excellent. Et le théâtre la passionne également. Elle poursuit des études en art dramatique à l'Université d'Ottawa. Merci, Adèle. Monsieur Paul-Émile L’Heureux, qui est un enseignant de français et des arts à la retraite, un agriculteur biologique dans la région de White Fox, près de Nipawin, où il a vécu 34 ans. Il est impliqué dans la communauté francophone. Il est élu député communautaire pour l'Assemblée communautaire francaskoise. Merci, M. L’Heureux. Sophie Ferré. Oui, fais foi, Sophie. Sophie est née à Saskatoon. Elle est diplômée de l'École canadienne française. Elle détient un bac en sciences sociales avec une spécialisation en sciences politiques de l'Université d'Ottawa, tout récemment graduée. Elle est impliquée dans l'association Jeunesse francaskoise depuis son adolescence. Elle est aujourd'hui la présidente de cette association provinciale. Merci, Sophie. Et dernièrement, M. Henri Gareau, qui complète notre carré. M. Gareau est né à Bellevue. Henri travaille comme fermier dans la région, toujours, c'est dans son sang. Il est engagé dans la communauté il a été député communautaire de l'Assemblée communautaire francaskoise aussi. Il a représenté Batoche, Bellevue et Saint-Laurent auprès du conseil municipal de la municipalité de Saint-Louis pour une douzaine d'années. Et depuis 2006, il est le chef, le préfet de la municipalité rurale. Il siège présentement aussi au conseil de l'Association culturelle de Bellevue et au conseil d'administration de Friends of Batoche. Alors, merci Henri d'être ici. Bienvenue à tous et nous allons commencer par vous poser une question qui est quand même assez large, mais qui va quand même faire ressortir ce que vous avez en vous, à l'intérieur, dans votre cœur. La question est, qu'est-ce que ça veut dire pour moi? Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire d'être un francophone? Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire d'être un métis? Alors, on aimerait vous inviter tout simplement, qui serait le premier à faire le saut, puis à réfléchir sur cette question. Toujours dans l'intention de partager qui nous sommes pour mieux se comprendre à la fin de la discussion.
I just would like to add that I think that it's important to remember that there's all kinds of personalities in the room, and there's going to be some of you who like to get to know each other a little bit better before you start to jump in with some of the stuff that's a little closer to your heart. There are some people who are prepared to just speak right now about issues that are really important. There are people who are here looking for information, and there are people who are here looking for answers and solutions and how are we going to move forward. So those are all great reasons to be here, and it's why we are all here. So just remember that when you're listening, you have your own way of listening, and you have your own way of participating in this, and we want to make room over the next day for everybody to have a chance to participate and for everybody to be heard. So whatever we can do to facilitate that. And I want to add something to my bio that I feel personally is kind of hanging in the air here. I have been working for the last year on the election issues in Saskatchewan for the Métis Nation Saskatchewan. And because we don't want to turn this into a political box in any way, but we definitely want to acknowledge that we are in the midst of a bit of a political crisis in Saskatchewan, and not to ignore that or put that aside, but not to sort of breathe it back into life here. And I think that it's something that's sort of around us and involves what we say and who we talk to. So just to bring that out and put it in the middle of the room and say we know it's here. And we're dealing with it. And as a result of having some political turmoil, of course, we don't have a lot of forums in Saskatchewan for the Métis community to be voicing a lot of the issues that are bothering us. So today what we're going to do is find some, hopefully some relationships with the Francophone community so that we can say, what's your experience in that community dealing with some of these issues and how can we move forward on that? As well as things that we will talk about in terms of relationships among our groups together. So just to put that out there right off the bat, and then to invite some conversation, and as Francine said, we'll go back and forth with the table and with the audience. So just again, to we need our participants to press the button on their microphone so they can, when they participate, and to shut it off when they're not, so the wind isn't giving us some feedback. And to start with the question of who are you as a Métis person? What does it mean in your community? And if we've got anybody that's jumping up and down and can't wait to talk, it'll warm you up, okay? You'll get warm if you get to speak. That's the incentive.
I'm Benoit Perret, and I'm a proud Canadian. Saying said that, I'm also a proud French Canadian, which I speak my language. Whenever I meet someone that's French, we totally switch to French. What is back in my background that I found that hurt me sometimes, way back, when you used to fill a form and you used to say, what's your nationality? I was so proud to fill down, I'm French Canadian. And lately they took that root away from me, that I'm French. Like that one of the speakers said last night, be proud what you are. And that's where we have to start. We're proud that I'm French. You're proud that whatever you stand for in life, where your parents brought you to be. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur Perret. Qui d'autre aimerait ajouter à ça?
Good morning to everyone. I'm going to speak in English, and maybe there'll be opportunity for me to speak in the language that I grew up with later, but I'll have to do simultaneous translation for everyone, I think. But for the moment, this is the, because it's the, English has been the language that I have had to use for work, it's the one that I feel most conversant in at the very moment, so that's where I want to start. I think the question you've put in front of us is complex and yet simple. And so I want to start at a personal level, first of all, in terms of my own identity as a Métis woman. As far back as I can remember, I was born into the community of Île-la-Crosse. And the history of that region, of course, shapes my identity. I was raised by my grandparents on an island on the lake in Île-la-Crosse. And I lived on that island with my family, and I mean my extended family, my aunts and my uncles lived on that island along with my grandmother and my grandfather. And it is also the way in which the rest of the community was structured. You knew where the Laliberté's lived, you knew where the Daignon's lived, you know where the Aubuchon family lived, and this is where the Gardner family lived. And so we lived closely, working, I guess, interdependently, if you would call it that. And we were also a community. And so my memory of that place has shaped me as a Métis person. Growing up in that community, we were the dominant members of that community. And so I have to say that I did not have an identity crisis, so to speak, because I knew I was Métis. Were there identity issues as I moved south to get an education? For sure, and which takes me to this complexity of what I started to say. It's simple and yet complex. I think that in order to understand who we are as Métis people in the broader national, global context, and I'm speaking internationally, I think Paul Chartrand's comments this morning reinforced for me that we are shaped, our identity is also shaped by our history and the history of this place. And if we neglect to go as far back as we can to the history of this place and the people who lived here, I am talking about the indigenous people of this place. We do ourselves a disservice in talking not only about our own identity, but also our relationships with each other. And I think we need to be frank as well that we are, this is a colonized place. And with that, of course, has been the central issue related to that from the beginning until the present day has been the issue of land. And so it's very central to my community. And so while I say I was shaped simply by my family and the music and the laughter and the stories of where we came from, I was also shaped by the story of this country as far as I was not there at 2005 when the event first occurred between the Métis and the Francophone. So I have no sense of what happened there. And so when I think forward about, you know, the kind of relationship we might forge, I think it has to be with the awareness of that complex history. We need to acknowledge what is that relationship. I'll leave it there for now.
Thank you, Rita. Paul-Émile?
Merci. Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire d'être francophone? Mais ça veut dire différentes choses pour différentes personnes. Moi, je vois que dans les petits centres, dans la Saskatchewan, c'est difficile. Dans le gros centre, c'est peut-être plus facile selon ce qu'on fait. Pour moi, personnellement, aujourd'hui, je suis fier. Plus fier que jamais dans ma vie. Quand on était jeune, ma famille, mes frères, mes sœurs, des fois on avait un peu honte, on n'était pas fiers. On pensait au début que tout le monde était francophone, puis après ça, on a réalisé que, oh non, on est dans un océan anglophone, et puis où on était élevé, c'était pas tellement difficile, parce qu'il y avait beaucoup de francophones là, à Gravelbourg, mais à un moment donné, on voulait pas être identifié trop comme francophone, on voulait pas avoir d'accent, on voulait surtout, fit in, on voulait pas qu'on soit identifié comme les Froggies ou les Frenchies. Puis on s'est fait appeler ça une couple de fois, mais vraiment, tu sais, moi, Frenchie, ok, Frenchie, ouais, je peux t'appeler toutes sortes de noms. T'sais. Moi, ça ne m'a pas affecté tellement, mais je sais qu'il y en a qui n'aiment pas ça. La communauté où j'habite maintenant, dans le nord-est de la province, je pense qu'il y a encore beaucoup de monde, surtout les jeunes, qui. Ça n'a pas changé. Ils sont comme je l'étais quand j'étais teenager. Ils sont pas tellement fiers d'être francophones. Ça dépend de la situation. Quand ils sont avec leurs amis, leur famille, OK, pas de problème. Mais quand ils sortent, quand ils vont, je sais pas, au cinéma, quand ils vont à Paris, quand ils vont... deux francophones vont se parler anglais ou en frères et sœurs. J'entends ça tout le temps. Alors, C'est difficile en Saskatchewan si on est surtout dans les petites communautés, d'être francophone, de garder notre savoir-faire, notre savoir-parler. Et puis la solution, ben, moi j'ai toutes sortes d'idées, mais en tout cas, là, je vais laisser ça là pour tout de suite. Merci.
Merci, Paul-Émile. Est-ce qu'il y a une autre personne qui serait intéressée à ajouter à son vécu, à son expérience? Sophie?
Allô? Alors, moi, je voulais juste un peu faire du pouce sur ce que Paul-Émile a dit, puis aussi sur ce que Terry a dit hier soir. Ce que j'ai vraiment aimé de ce que tu as dit hier, c'est you can feel yourself. Et puis, excuse-moi. Pour moi, ça, c'est la clé d'être francophone. Alors, c'est mille et une choses, puis c'est juste une chose. Puis pour moi, c'est cette sensation que tu as en toi, que tu sais qui tu es. Excusez-moi.
Merci beaucoup.
Non, c'est correct. J'ai d'autres choses à dire.
Oui, continue.
Alors, aussi pour toucher sur la présentation à Joanne hier soir, on voit qu'il y a, surtout dans la communauté fransaskoise, on essaye de s'unir possiblement avec un organisme. Et on voit aussi qu'il y a, je ne peux même pas compter le nombre d'organismes qui existent dans notre communauté. Et puis, comme jeune fransaskoise, je me sens un peu tiraillée de tous côtés pour essayer de tout faire, puis m'impliquer un peu partout, pour essayer d'aider dans tous les aspects de ma vie puis de ma francophonie. Alors, pour moi, le fait qu'être francophone, c'est un rapport avec la langue, et puis que la langue transcende tout domaine de ma vie, ça fait que j'ai beaucoup de misère à concentrer mes efforts sur une chose en particulier, parce que je veux tout faire, puis je veux tellement être capable de vivre ma francophonie partout où je vais, partout où je suis, que c'est un peu ça mon défi comme francophone, c'est d'être capable d'aider à mon maximum et puis d'être un peu partout en même temps. Puis je trouve ça difficile.
Thank you very much. Susan?
Bonjour. Hello, my name is Susan McKenzie, and I just wanted to start by talking about my bio a little bit because it's misinformation in my bio. I was born in a place called Red Lake, Ontario. My father, who was here a couple of, he just left this morning, his name is Alan McKenzie. My mother is Martha Mahar. She's from the East Coast in Nova Scotia. I think it's really important that I share a little bit about my background and to say, first and foremost, I wanted to honor the elders that were here that had brought me to this place today. I wanted to take this time to say, Maria, I love you and respect you, and I am very grateful for the teachings and the lessons, and also you just taking in my family and being kind and generous to us, and as well as the other elders who had pushed me along to help me get here to Batoche and here at this table. Once again, I was born in Red Lake, Ontario. I was raised in Winnipeg, Manitoba. I was raised by my mother, my Irish mother, whom I love and respect very much. And I had a difficult childhood. I grew up downtown Winnipeg. I still consider myself a downtown Winnipeg girl. We lived in Winnipeg at a time when there was a number of people coming in from the reserves and so forth, the Desjardins or Desjardins and Morissettes, and all these families were coming into the cities, and these are the people that I grew up with on Good Street by the Hudson Bay Company. I was very fortunate in many ways to become involved in the arts, and I was involved with a theater group called Red Roots Theater, and it was there where I found a voice. It is there where I found, with a number of other individuals, Monica Marx, Louis Ogimau, I was able to find a sense of identity and a sense of community. And that is very important because in many ways I have a homeland in terms of where I am and who I am now, but as I was growing up, I didn't have a sense of the Métis Nation. And so it has taken a number of years and to get to where I am now, which is quite amazing because I work at Batoche. I work at Batoche National Historic Site. And so I've kind of had a lot of different growing pains in trying to find out who I am. And one of the things that I noticed about my son Modeste behind me is that he was making a lot of racket, and I could hear him even though I had these on, but he was jigging. His foot is constantly jigging. He's always dancing. And I thought, wow, what a place to be. Here we are, and this is what my son is learning. And I guess that was important for me to start with the introduction because we've come a long way. And regardless of where we come from, the teachings and the elders and the experiences and the land itself will teach us. And so I just wanted to share that and say thank you very much for allowing me to participate. And it's such an honor to be here and to listen to the stories and see the emotion and love and respect that everyone has for their own cultures. And as well, I hope that's expanded and extended so we learn to respect the diversity within the two communities and celebrate it as well. So thank you.
Thank you. Terry?
Bonjour. Excuse-moi, je lis. Un petit filet de piquette, ben on Bruce sera bon d'être là. Je vous dire un petit blague où je viens, comme ça je vais comprendre comment que ça va dire plus tard. Je viens pas trop loin de site, c'est de Saint-Laurent. J'ai commencé l'école là à Fourmont. J'ai 6 ans, je ne veux pas parler d'anglais encore, je ne parlais pas d'anglais en tout. Ma première journée d'école, je ne savais pas le job, c'est que ça faisait là. Et mon petit pur, je m'ai fait malade. Le maître d'école m'a envoyé une petite lettre à mes parents. Il a dit, I think little Terry's sick. And I think he's lonesome. On the way home, I knew there was something in that letter that I didn't want my mom to see. So I dropped that note on the way home. She went to the store that later on that day, she found that damn note. And she came back and she said, you had a rough day at school. No, no. She said, I found the note. I said, oh. That was the introduction to the English language for me. What does it mean for me to be Métis? It meant family. Real strong family, as much as we have around here. We talk with the Francophone community. They have a strong family ties. We went through school at Fourmont for 7 years, I guess. We had a couple years that we went to BC, but we came back. And everything was just lovely. Everything was grand. We had a good time. I went to grade 8 in St. Louis. Again, there was a lot of Métis people there. I had an okay time. It was later that this thing called racism started to spring forth. We did not really understand it. We weren't really prepared for it. I remember the first overt time that it happened. I was at a party in Melfort, Saskatchewan. And some guy came over to me and said, we don't have your people here. And I didn't know what he meant. And I got asked to leave. To my benefit, there were some friends that were there, and they said, if he leaves, we leave. And that started that whole balance, that there's some people that feel a particular way that you have to accept. You don't necessarily have to completely accepted in your soul, but they have a right to an opinion. there's some of those opinions we can't change. And it started a long journey of trying to sort out who are the people you want to be around, who are the people that you want to be associated with. And that's been my journey, and now I see it through the eyes of my child, who's now 7. And we talk about who can you associate with that will you'll grow up to have a really good outlook in life, and that you can be proud of who you are. And I'm damn proud to be a really strong Métis person, man, in this community right now. It just says Sophie's proud to be Francophone. It brings my heart to tears to hear her speak so passionately as we speak passionately for our people as well. Thank you.
Oui, Lucille.
C'est mon tour à parler un petit peu passionnant de notre fierté des Français. Toute ma vie, j'étais très fière d'être une petite fille française. Tu m'as émotionnée, tu vois. J'ai été élevée avec la famille, nous autres aussi. On allait chez ma mère puis papa. Gareau, dans ce temps-là, prendre des beaux grands soupers avec tous nos cousins, nos cousines. Nos tantes. Et puis, ça virait toujours avec de la musique et une danse. Et puis, nos oncles, ils jouaient de la musique. Et puis, on riait toujours parce que quand c'était une valse, ça allait bien tranquillement. Puis, la musique était belle. Et quand c'était un polka ou un two-step, ça allait juste un petit peu plus vite. La même musique, mais un petit peu plus vite. C'était beau. On était enchantés avec ça. Et puis, j'ai toujours pensé qu'on était tous pareils parce que. On parlait tous un petit peu différent. On avait des tantes qui parlaient leur français différent que mon oncle, ou bien mon oncle qui parlait un petit peu différent le français que ma tante. Et comme ça, les cousins et les cousines, on avait, il y en a qui disaient papa, puis il y en avait qui disaient papa. On se comprenait, on s'aimait. J'ai été au couvent à Saint-Louis. Puis là aussi, j'ai découvert qu'il y avait des beaux petits-enfants avec des cheveux très foncés et des yeux noirs et qui étaient beaux et étaient belles. Et puis eux autres aussi, ils parlaient différent. J'ai jamais pensé qu'on était différent. Juste, jamais pensé à ça. Mais quand on a eu la chance de déménager à White Fox, c'est là que j'ai vu qu'il y avait une grosse différence dans le monde. Parce qu'il y en avait du monde là qui nous haïssait à cause qu'on parlait différent qu'eux. Puis, ça m'a démonté. Ça m'a vraiment demandé. C'est la première fois que j'ai découvert que, hey, on n'était pas aimés. Il y avait quelque chose d'autre à part de français. Depuis ce temps-là, j'ai encore la fierté d'être française. Je vais toujours avoir ça. Et puis, en vieillissant, dans les ouvrages que j'ai faits, j'ai trouvé que c'était une asset d'être capable de parler en français. Et je suis fière de ça et je suis fière aujourd'hui. Merci.
Simone.
Good morning. Okay, good morning, everybody. When you first asked the question, what does it mean to be Métis? I had to really think about it. Because unlike Rita, she always knew her identity, I struggled for a long time. Because when I was growing up, the nuns taught us that we were nobody. Like, we weren't First Nations, we weren't white, we were half-breeds. So I struggled with that for a long time. I worked hard on myself and really studied, like, in my heart, what does it mean to be Métis? And today I can say I'm a very proud Métis, proud of our distinct culture. And I'm teaching my children and grandchildren today to really be proud of who we are. We're special people. And when I was first asked to come here, I'm a replacement, by the way. I wasn't the first choice, but when I was asked to come here, I asked myself what can I contribute to this group? Like, I'm just an old grandma from northern Saskatchewan, and you know, I'm not a political person. I'm not an expert on Métis history. All I can offer is how I grew up Métis. And like Terry, I couldn't speak a word of English when I started school. I spoke Métis, and I still do today. I remember the first day of school, we were taught by nuns. And my older sisters were teaching me a few English words because they were in school already. And they said, the first question the nuns will probably ask you is, what's your name? And the second question might be, how old are you? So I went to school the first day, just really proud, ready for any questions. So the nun asked me a question. I said, Simone Laliberté. And everyone started laughing. And then she asked me another question. I said, 6 years old. I guess I got the questions backwards. But anyway, I speak my language, and I don't think it'll be possible for anybody to translate my language the way it is today in my community, because we integrate three languages into one. Like, we use Cree, French, and what is the other one mentioned? Like, this started in Pine House, our neighboring community. They would say, like, parking. We'd say, parko, parko, yach. That means we were parked. That iglis means church. We integrate three languages, and we like having fun. We like dancing, jigging, laughing. Laughing about ourselves, making fun of ourselves, not in a bad way, but you know, that's how we heal. Because we, I don't know, we had hard times, hard struggles, but that's all in the past. I think now we have to move forward as a Métis nation. We have strong leaders in northern Saskatchewan. We have people like Max Morin, Alex Maurice, who is the mayor of Beauval. He's a strong advocate for Métis, to promote our culture, to be proud of who we are, to teach our children that we be proud to be Métis. I guess our first annual Métis Cultural Festival is going to be happening the end of this month. And I have I'm very emotional about that, because the people who fought for our Métis rights are almost all gone now. They're passed on. But in their memory, we'll make it a great event. So that's for now.
That's good. Anybody else at the table like to comment? Adèle?
Je vais rapprocher le micro tout de suite.
Oui.
Alors, je viens de Belleville. Alors, nécessairement, je suis francophone. Je viens de la région de Batoche. Alors, nécessairement, je suis métisse. Je me considère une petite métisse francophone. J'ai toujours su que j'étais francophone depuis ma jeunesse. Aussitôt que tu vas à l'école avec la DSF, it's like pounded into your skull, t'es francophone. Mais j'ai pas su que j'étais métisse avant que j'étais 15, 16, même 17 ans. Là, ma mère a commencé à faire un peu de recherche. Puis j'ai su que mon arrière-grand-père était sur le gouvernement provisoire de Riel, ici à Batoche. Puis là, c'est une énorme fierté pour moi. Aussi pouvoir travailler là, travailler avec bien des gens qui ont l'héritage, la culture en commun avec moi. It's shocking. Je vais dire en anglais. It shocks me. And in the greatest way possible. Être francophone et métis, pour moi, c'est faire partie d'une communauté qui est accueillante, qui est fière de cet héritage, de cette culture. C'est une langue aussi, la langue est tellement importante. Ma langue française, j'en perds quand je reviens à Bellevue. C'est un peu étrange, mais être à Ottawa, j'ai amélioré mon français. Mais en revenant à Bellevue, j'en perds un petit peu et ça me rend un peu triste. Mais c'est aussi du travail. Il faut toujours travailler pour garder sa culture. C'est ça le plus grand défi et ce qui me démontre comme francophone métisse de la région, c'est que je travaille toujours pour m'améliorer. Merci.
Merci, Adèle. J'aimerais inviter d'autres gens. Monsieur Bruce, est-ce que vous êtes prêt? Merci.
Good morning. I'm very honored to be chosen to sit here. It was supposed to be to sit around a round table, but now we find ourselves sitting around a square table. But that won't change anything. I was born as a Métis in the Bellevue community in French for a few years, took my schooling there. In 58, I happened to move in this area, the Batoche community. By 61, I started working at the Batoche National Historic Park. For 2 years, I was working under somebody else. By 1962, I was left all by myself, all alone, at the Batoche Historic Site as a Métis person to run the park by myself. By 64, I started getting my first internship. Build it up to what I had to supervise was 15 internships. And during that time, this is where I learned what a Métis person in a community could learn or operate a site of that size. So I was very fortunate to work with different people, all nationality, were coming to me to work at the Batoche Historic Park. I was very fortunate to have this job till 1994. Thank you.
Merci. Henri?
Hier, on a parlé beaucoup de les langues, la langue française, la langue métisse. Puis, je suis vraiment impressionné de voir comment ça a évolué ou ça n'a pas évolué. À partir de mes grands-parents qui étaient à Border, au presbytère ici, puis ils étudiaient sous Mademoiselle Dorval, qui était supposée d'être bien stricte pour la grammaire et la prononciation. Puis moi, qui ai été à l'école, je m'ai fait taper des doigts à cause qu'on disait « moins pitoué ». Puis mes enfants qui étudient, ça c'était à travers la division scolaire, avaient lu. Puis on parle encore « moins pitoué ». Puis, tu sais, alors ça n'a pas évolué. Je trouve que c'est vraiment intéressant. Comment le monde qui a regardé dehors hier soir, puis on dit « Je pense qu'il va pleuvoir ce soir. » Le vent a regardé dehors puis a dit, il va mouiller, boy. C'est de même qu'on parle encore. Puis on est fiers de ça. Je veux dire, on fait un effort quand on va à des réunions françaises. On essaie d'améliorer notre français, mais à Belleville, c'est de même qu'on parle. On parle moi puis toi, puis il va mouiller, boy. Merci.
Merci, Henri.
I'll go last because I work with a bunch of women, so I'm used to going last.
Careful, Scott.
I'm protected by the tables. But like Adèle was saying, I'm also French and Métis, and I actually found out later than her. I only found out when I was like 22, so that I was Métis. I knew I was French. I went to French school. My parents always spoke French and all that kind of stuff, and I was really proud about that. And when I found out I was Métis, like, I thought that was really cool because I always learned a little bit, like I learned about Batoche in school, but not very much. And when I found out it was something I really wanted to learn more about, and I wanted to learn more about myself through that, and I found it very hard because there's not a lot of information at hand about Métis people, which really, well, it sucks. And I don't know, like, I am proud to be Métis. I tell everybody that I'm Métis, and they're like, wow, Scott, that's really cool. You're awfully white to be Métis. I know, but it's true, trust me. But it's something that I'm really proud of. And growing up as a French person, I didn't experience any hardships for being French and Métis like other people have talked about. And I think that's just the way that the community is changing as a whole, and people are becoming more accepting of the diversity of Canada, which is a really good thing. I'm not saying there isn't racism, because there is. There's a lot. Don't misunderstand me. I'm saying that more people are more accepting. Like, I wouldn't get kicked out of a party for going because I'm Métis. That wouldn't happen now, as I know. I never have been. Hopefully it doesn't happen, because that must have been terrible. I couldn't even imagine what that would be like. But I'm saying, me growing up was easier than you guys growing up. I think that's what I'm getting at. Thanks.
Maria Campbell.
I grew up in West Side in a Road Lounge community, like many of the people who are here. We were not privileged in growing up in a community where there was just Métis people, or there was people who had a different identity. In our community, there were people who were Métis, there were people who were half-breeds. We were Catholic, some of us, and some of us were Anglican. And there were also Métis people who practiced the old religion of their grandmothers. We didn't own land. We were not allowed to go to school until the mid-1940s because we were not taxpayers. And I think that's something that a lot of people don't understand. When they think that Métis went to school, they're thinking of communities like Île-aux-Crosses, where there were schools and those were established communities. But if you were not a taxpayer, you were considered a squatter. Most of the people who lived on road allowances were descendants of the people who were at Batoche. And those people paid a big price for their families being involved in that. Now, I don't want to sound like bad news, wicked witch of Batoche here, but, you know, we're being very kind to each other, and I'm saying this with the greatest respect for everybody, and especially the organizers of this conference, but I think we need to, if we're going to develop a relationship, we need to talk about the issues that have really kept us apart when people say they suffered a little bit of discrimination or racism, maybe a couple of times somebody said I was called a frog or a Frenchman. I can't remember a day growing up when we were not called les sauvages because we were Métis people in a community. Being kicked out of stores, not being able to walk on the sidewalk with other people. That didn't just happen with Anglophones, it also happened with Francophones. And that dysfunction carried over into our families, because in our communities we were Catholic and we were Anglican. And so when Paul talked this morning about how we learn the language that's around us, that's really true, because we also practice those ugly dysfunctions on each other. And you ended up with Métis people who put each other down because some of them were Anglicans or some of them were Catholic, and ended up with those divisions, and even further created divisions by calling each other sauvage because our language wasn't exactly the same as other people in the community. In my community, we spoke several languages. Some people talked Métis. And again, Terry talked about the diversity in our language. Some people spoke Métis, which was mostly French and Cree, that mixture. But there were some people who spoke Métis, but they also spoke Gaelic in that mixture, or they spoke more Cree or maybe more Soto. So it was really diverse just in one small community. And that's not just my community, that's communities both in the south and central parts of Saskatchewan, because there were many road lounge communities. People don't realize that in the 1940s, those same road lounge people were kicked out of those communities. Many of them, their homes were burned down and they were relocated to other places where nobody wanted them, and they had to move again. When Scott said there's very little history of Métis people that he can find, that's really true, because most people don't know that. They know the fur trade history, but they don't understand the contemporary history of our people. In the 1940s, people were loaded up in cattle cars and moved out of their communities, and they watched their communities being burned. You know, racism, it's still there. To say that there's no racism in our community today is wrong. People still get kicked out of places because they're Métis. And that happens to them from all of these different relatives or kinsmen whose blood runs through their veins. We're very nasty to each other. A lot of the kinds of issues that we face today in trying to establish our nation comes from that kind of ugliness. But the really important thing is that our culture has been able to stay alive. I don't know how. I often marvel at how we've been able to be strong through all of that diversity and still, like Simone says, be able to laugh and maybe that's what's been our salvation, is that we can laugh and tell stories and continue. But we need to talk about those kinds of things and how do we make those changes. I remember reading something written by an Irish poet who said that nations are not built in the Houses of Parliament, but they're built in the way that people laugh and talk and make pilgrimage together, and I think that's what we're doing here. But we really need to talk. I'm proud to be Métis. I've always been proud of that. I'm proud to be a half-breed, and I'm proud that my Métis has a lot of Cree in it, because I'm very proud of those grandmothers that made me a mixed blood woman. But my feelings are not any more generous toward the Francophone community than they are to the Anglophone community, because I grew up next to a French community and they treated us every bit as bad as the English community on that side. And I just wanted to say that and understand that there were many, many communities who were totally dispossessed, who had no land and just moved around from place to place like a bunch of gypsies and were totally invisible in this country. And many of those people are responsible for our organizations today and our institutions, and that's a reality that we still live with today, because we still do those kinds of things to each other. So I needed to get that off my chest. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Maria. We'll get a response. Thank you. We'll get a response from Paul-Émile, and then we'll go.
Well, I don't know. Well, maybe it's a response, but I hate to think that it was a national ethnic thing, you know, the way the French treated the Métis and the English treated the Métis. I think it was a generational thing. I think in the past, a lot of crazy things were going on for... You'd shoot people for stealing a horse. People were hanged for stealing, jewelry from the rich people. We did some crazy things in the past. I've seen a lot of change, you know, as a teacher. Scott was talking about, you know, he didn't see those things that Terry saw or I saw. No, it's not cool today. It's not cool to be a racist. J'ai entendu ma mère appeler faire allusion aux sauvages puis aux... Qu'est-ce que tu fais de des plantes nègres? Des plantes nègres, quand j'étais jeune, je ne savais pas qu'est-ce que c'était un nègre. Tu sais, nos parents avaient... Puis nos grands-parents, des fois, avaient cette mentalité-là de raciste. Tu sais, on est mieux qu'eux autres. Eux autres, tu sais, le système de classe que... Peut-être les Anglais amenés de l'Angleterre. Ça. En tout cas, le monde sont beaucoup plus fiers aujourd'hui d'être ceux qui sont métis ou francophones ou ukrainiens ou polonais. Je pense que les choses s'améliorent beaucoup et puis il va y avoir d'autres changements. Et puis qu'on veut pas oublier le passé parce qu'on veut pas répéter les mêmes fautes. Mais tant qu'à moi... Tout le monde, on dit là, autour de la table, qui se sentent fiers, puis que things are looking up.
Merci, Paul-Émile. Je pense qu'il y avait quelqu'un dans l'audience. Je vais donner la parole à Terry, because the people... Okay, and Madame... Should I go to Madame Blondeau? Okay, je vais aller à Madame Blondeau, and then Terry. And then I think someone over there, and then...
There has been many years wasted in regards to getting rid of racism in our civilization in Saskatchewan, but for somebody to believe that it is gone is not really looking at where the racism happens. And as far as where it happens, nobody wants to go and see where it happens. Nobody wants to see where poverty happens. We have politicians that pledge to get rid of poverty or that everybody will have a fair chance. But in the end, what happens is they always pick and choose. They don't speak to people where they think they might get an adverse conversation that they don't necessarily want to hear. And I think it's highly time that people just looked at the very facts of life that we have lived. And now I'm not saying that I have been horribly unhappy. As a matter of fact, it's just the opposite. I've been almost totally happy. What I don't like is the things that have happened where society turned a blind eye and my own people who I worked hard to see that they could get an education and go to university in those places. I don't talk like this just at gatherings like this. I stand in the middle of a political party's convention or their meetings or where they're electing candidates, and I tell them that. History has been mentioned here. As a matter of fact, I think a little too much is leaned on this way past history. For one thing, I know I probably won't be spoken to for the next 20 years, but I'm going to say it anyway. There's one thing that the Métis people and the First Nations people have never done. They have never been caught in a rusty old ship or a rusty shipping can trying to sneak into somebody else's country. We have never run away from our difficulties. We are trying to solve them here. Hopefully this will be a step towards that direction, because I hope you will understand that if you don't look at the bad, you will never change it.
Thank you, Mrs. Blondeau-Perry. Terry?
I'd like to thank Maria for bringing this to the next level, because one of my particular things was, now that we've dispensed with the hugs and kisses, let's get down to the crap. And there's been a lot of crap, and there continues to be crap. And it's alive and well, and we need to talk about it. We need to sit down and say, what is actually going on out there? We have an organization right now that works with Métis people, and we have some Métis youngsters who are going around in our community with fish bats in their boots. They got knives in their pockets because some of the white folks, and I'm not attacking the Francophone community here, talking about people in general who are attacking them on the street. That's a problem. That's a problem that we need to deal with. Yes, we can start at this particular level and dialogue with one another and find out, but we've got to admit that there's something going on. If we don't admit that there's something going on, we can't do anything about it. Yes, I speak very passionately with this. Yes, I may appear angry because I'm damn mad. That's why. I'm upset with this. We like to go around hugging and kissing each other. But as Maria has also said, we're also very mean to each other. And it's tiring. I'm sick of it. So thank you, Maria.
Ça marche pas? Okay. Now, back to the audience, Monsieur Morissette.
Merci. If you don't look at the bad, you will never change it, you said. But does the bad look at you? It's something else. I just want to react very briefly to Maria's word, because I feel so moved by her voice. Let me tell it to her and to you all. It is such a sensible voice, and it is beautiful. That's the only thing I want to say. It is so beautiful. The first time I read Half-Bred, Half-Breed, many years ago, like 20, 25 years ago, it had, albeit the content, there was an appeal to it that I could never explain, Maria. Like a word that was familiar to us and that we were never told about. And besides, I was reading it in English. Of course it was written in English. But I was not understanding it in English. In which language? I can't tell, except it was a language close to the heart. Merci.
Thank you, Jean. Susan, please go ahead.
Last night, when I was listening to the music and thoroughly enjoying the different styles of the fiddling. Someone behind me said, don't worry, we'll make you into a Frenchman yet. And I think the point that my French is, I love the idea of learning many languages, and I respect all languages. But I think the fact that I was raised in English, primarily English, my father lost his language. My father lost his language for many reasons, and one, because they were trying to survive. Every day was such a survival for him. And I was really touched by my father's presence in the last couple of days, because some of these issues of loss of identity, language, and are still so relevant and seen throughout the communities, and especially with the youth. And I too am very concerned with the children and the youth, and the sort of this generations where it's heading with the gang development and so forth, and the poverty. It still sickens me every day, and it's still so obvious everywhere you go. I live in Rostern now, and sometimes when we go into stores, we still have problems. You know, we still have people looking at us, and we still have some of those feelings that it's hard to describe. It's hard to talk about, because it's really hard to take people to task on some of the racism that still exists in the communities today. So I just wanted to share, I really feel that the racism is still here, and I feel it. I feel it in many times. So.
Merci beaucoup, Susan. Et juste pour vous dire, dans la communauté francophone, c'est sûr que nous vivons un certain genre de racisme. Même moi, des fois, je me suis déjà fait dire, hein, quand je parle en français avec ma fille dans un magasin, « speak white ». Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire, ça? C'est toute une insulte. Alors, je pense qu'on vit beaucoup, je peux comprendre un peu ce que la communauté métisse vit, c'est sûr et certain. Et je suis très touchée par ce que j'entends jusqu'à date. Alors, on va continuer. Rita, I think you wanted a word.
After you listen to people, just as we said yesterday, you find yourself rethinking, I guess, what I originally wanted to share. But that's okay. And that I guess is an expression that I'm listening to what I hear, and the passion in everyone's voice about what's important. And I just want to revisit a point I made earlier, but first of all, want to acknowledge this passion that I'm picking up. Because I've worked for many years in the field of education, I've heard it often when people come together to address the issue of racism. People speak about how we are the same at a very, very deep level. We want the same things. We have the same needs. And when I say needs, basic needs for shelter, a place to belong, to be loved, to be respected, all those things. And we have aspirations as well, to be more than that, which is a spiritual essence of ourselves as human beings. And so when we come together, I can hear that. Our histories are important to us, our families are important to us, our cultures are important to us, our language is important to us. To all of us. I made a comment when I started about the complexity of this thing called identity, which is, I think, at the heart of it. And I think Paul uncovered it for me again this morning, not because I wasn't aware of it, but I think if we are unwilling to acknowledge the history of this country and the foundations upon which it's built, the thinking that's embedded in the legislation, in the politics of this country,
we're dead. And because we are, our relationships are shaped by it. The laws of this country are, in many respects, racist. They denigrate all of us and what we're aspiring to. Merci.
Thank you, Rita. Darren Prefontaine.
Thank you. I just wanted to thank everybody for this discussion, because I do think it's a passionate and it's a necessary one. But I just wanted to bring up a few points about the pea soup, you know, the frog thing. What English and French people, it's a fight amongst other white men, and it was nasty. The Klan burned crosses against our people, but it's qualitatively different what happened to Aboriginal people. We can't forget that. Our people were still prime ministers. They were bankers. They were part of the Catholic Church that dispossessed the Métis people through the script system. We got to remember that, too. The English took the boots to our people, our ancestors, le Canadiens, but our people did the same to the Métis in many instances. In a community where I'm very familiar with Willowbunch, I could tell you horror stories. My mother was a German background, and she told me a story one day about a French-Canadian priest who went and took pictures of all the Métis people, told them to disrobe, roll around in the dirt, and then took picture and then said, please give money to these poor savages. They need money. And what he did is he lined his pockets, or it went to French-Canadian farmers. And my own mother told me that story. And she's neither Francophone or Métis, but that stuck with her. I wished I remembered the priest's name, but I mean, stuff like that happened down there. And my cousin is over there, and we have people down there. We don't know what happened on the ground. Were our people involved indirectly or directly? But we're all here together. We talk about our great-grandpa, my cousin Lorraine and I. He was a legislator from Quebec who went to Saint-Eustache, Manitoba. There's a gentleman named Raoul Mackay. He has a show called Les Voix de Métis on APTN. I was talking with him. He had roots in Saint-Eustache. My great-grandpa took his grandpa's script land through the church. Well, that was one of the most awkward moments in my life. Here this old gentleman from Manitoba comes, and I work at GDI. And we sat down, and it was really cathartic. But on the other hand, it was sad, because this is our interrelated history with one another. And it was ugly in parts. Not always, but it was ugly, and we got to acknowledge that. Our people, the Canadiens, were good people. They were in a lot of ways, but they could be just as ugly as anybody else. We're all human beings. We all got demons. And part of the problem, I honestly think, and I hope I don't offend people, is the Catholic Church did a lot of the damage here. I've got a quote here from a priest who talked about the Métis being, I won't even read it, but anyone wants to look at it. This was written in 1923, and Willowbunch Museum was selling this up until recently. You know, and Lord Durham said something similar about our ancestors not having a history. They weren't a people. They were, you know, just bad people. And the French Canadians, the Quebecois, still quote Lord Durham's report. Well, you should have a look at Père Rondeau's write-up about the Métis that was written in 1923 and republished in 1970. And sold in Willowbunch, Saskatchewan, close to my hometown, Rockland, Saskatchewan. And there's a place that's colonized. You should go visit that place if you want to talk about dysfunction. Willowbunch, Rockland, that whole area, that's a place in utter denial. And that, if there's a healing that needs to get done, I suggest maybe next time we go down there. I don't know how it'll end out, but these are just my points. I don't know where I fit in the grand scheme of things. I'm not Métis, I'm not a Francophone, but I do have, you know, French-Canadian heritage. My stepdad was Métis, so I've got some interest. I work at GDI, but I try to find linkages and find commonalities, and the racism is there. Go to Saskatoon, our big city, it's gonna explode in that city. We have a child prostitute problem in Saskatoon. My girlfriend teaches women's and gender studies. Her friend works in the Women's and Gender Studies Department on par with Bangkok, Thailand. And that's Aboriginal girls. I mean, if you want to talk about racism, the white Johns are doing that to young Native girls. If those perverts went and molested little white girls, we'd call in the bloody Canadian Army, the RCMP. We'd be cracking heads. So, I mean, here I am almost, you know, I'm really upset about that issue because that's something I see. I work in the inner city. So we've got some demons, people, we got to overcome. And I hope I didn't ramble too much or was out of place, but these are my comments. Thank you.
Okay, so we have another speaker. Okay, Sophie, sorry, Sophie, okay.
I guess I kind of noticed that none of the Francophones at the table responded to the racism issue, and I think that that's partially because we don't know and we can't know. I mean, we can go in a store and speak French and have somebody say speak white, and I mean, it's happened to me, but at least I get to shut my mouth and pretend I'm not French anymore for a little while. Whereas if you're Métis or you're Aboriginal, that's there forever. You don't get to just shut your mouth and not be Métis anymore. And I just kind of wanted to acknowledge the fact that we're aware of the history and we're aware that it's ugly, as Darren said, in that, I mean, I live in Saskatoon and there's, I mean, I can honestly say that I'm scared to go to the west side. And I mean, do I get a little depressed every time I go and look and see what's going on down there? Of course I do. I mean, that's my city, that's where I grew up. And to know that there's people living in conditions that are worse than some third world countries, I mean, how can we not do anything about that? And I mean, I'm just disgusted every time I have my little white friends in suburbia, along with my parents, say that it's not going on and it's not as bad as we think it is. And I mean, how as a Francophone can I help? Is it even related? But I don't know, but as a human being, how can I let that go on, you know? And so if we can talk about how we can help each other out as human beings, never mind the cultural relation and how we know each other and we're linked that way as human beings, how do we move forward on just a social level? I mean, it's just, I don't know. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. And I just feel a little helpless listening to all these comments and going, I wish I could do something, but that's just who I am. Whenever something's going wrong, I just want to do something. So, I mean, if we can work on that this afternoon, have a chat, I don't know, but that's my comment.
Thank you, Sophie. So we're going to have another speaker from the audience. This is just like dating, you know, you start to get to know the people around you and then you find out they've got, you know, ugly scars they're going to show you and you're going to love them anyway. They have habits you don't like, you're going to love them anyway. You talk about the things that are hard to talk about and you're going to love each other anyway. And so I think that the hard question is, I'd like, Sophie, for you to feel very empowered by the conversation that's going on here. I think that your reaction is a very typical one. It's like, okay, like I feel terrible about it. What are we going to do about it? It's the what are we going to do about it part. It's the moving past it that we need to get to and say, okay, you need to acknowledge what's going on. We started today with talking about the pride in who we are, talking about where we come from and who we are, and how do you know who you are? How do you know inside of yourself who you are? And if your French language has carried you through that and it's maintained, it's not such a far reach to say, this is who I am, this is where I come from, this is what I stand for. If you have had your culture completely marginalized and you've been oppressed through, purposely, through legislation, through racism in your community, through religion, then it's harder. Our people are finding it, are struggling for, okay, now we have to demand respect for who we are. And that's coming out in the room right now. And it's all good. I'm going to open it up for one more comment. And I'm wondering if you're all getting hungry or not frozen at any event. So after we hear from this individual, Francois, we're going to break for lunch.
Just wanted to remind you that in most cases, there was some instances where the government did sponsor the racism, and also racism was pushed by the church. But we have to remember those oftentimes were individuals, and also a lot of the racism oftentimes happens through individuals. Hopefully our communities have grown that they have passed this stage of, you know, saying, well, our society is more evolved than yours or whatever. There's also something that Mr. Chatrin also spoke of, and that's, being taking political action about it. And I just remember that the French community just had a big meeting with the the French Canadian and Acadian Association out in Ottawa, and Saskatchewan put forward, we shouldn't be talking about us living as a minority anymore. And I was kind of surprised to see the question came out again, how do we cope as minorities? And I think it's part of that process. Eventually we have to go move forward, and we have to stop thinking ourselves as minority, because we'll paint ourselves as minority and we'll never get out of that box. Okay, we are Canadian citizens. Je suis un citoyen canadien et j'ai droit à être un citoyen avec les mêmes égalités que toutes les autres. Que je sois canadien français, que je sois métis, je suis encore canadien. And that takes a bit of, it takes practice, I guess, to put that into everyday life. I just remembered, I went out to Walmart, and you have these automatic checkouts. I hate going to in there and admitting you're going there. But anyways, I went, and I bought something. I bought some water. I was in a big rush, and I bought water. And I went to the checkout, automatic checkout, and you have the option, English or French. So I print French. And there's a loudspeaker there. It tells me, and I was in Swift Current. And it was like, I just put the spotlight on myself. But in some ways, it's good. It's good for other people to know that there are other people that have a variation of culture, of Canadian culture. It's not only English out here. There are variations, and there are different races, right? And so I think the more we put it out there, the better it is for everybody, because everybody will have to come to accept there's a diversity of cultures out there, and that is part of that Canadian identity. This is what I had to say. Thank you.
Merci, François.
Tanché, welcome. Bienvenue à Rendez-vous Batoche.
Bonjour tout le monde. Je suis contente que vous êtes revenus à la table. C'est bon signe, hein? Vous savez, quand on est assis autour d'une table comme ça, ce qui est beau, c'est qu'on se voit, on s'entend bien. Et ce que j'ai réalisé ce matin, c'est qu'on a beaucoup de choses à se dire, même si des fois, venant de différentes perspectives et différents vécus, c'est non important de connaître ça. Alors, je suis très contente que ça a pu ressortir, même la participation de l'audience qui vient enrichir le dialogue. Je pense qu'en faisant ça, on va pouvoir mettre en place une certaine empathie qui peut-être dans le passé, on n'était pas assis autour d'une table pour voir et se connaître. Donc, j'espère que cette empathie va continuer. Et en même temps, empathie, c'est plus que de la sympathie, hein? C'est vraiment essayer de comprendre et de voir comment on peut s'enrichir un et l'autre, toujours en se respectant. Alors, je vais laisser la parole à à Marilyn, mais j'espère qu'on va pouvoir continuer à échanger, surtout de la communauté francophone. Peut-être il y a eu des choses qui ont bien fonctionné chez nous. On pourra en parler de ça. Et j'aimerais entendre aussi des pistes qui existent dans la communauté métisse. Alors, ça va être... j'ai très hâte de voir ce qui va ressortir. Il n'y a rien de pré-écrit, pré-inscrit. Ça nous appartient. Et alors, maintenant, je laisse la parole à Marilyn.
OK, so... I want to start speaking French when I hear the translation in my ear the whole time I'm talking, so I have to take my earphone out. We started off on a very, very good note with the answer this morning. We started talking about, Mr. Perret talked about pride. And having pride in who you are and where you come from and how you hold on to that. And we talked about family. Passion always comes out in a Métis context. It doesn't matter what the reason is for the gathering. There's a passion that flows that brings us, brings our voice very strongly to the front. There are divisions. We talked about divisions. There's divisions within our own Métis communities. There are divisions between Métis and French communities. And there are divisions between Métis and French communities and other people. One of the things, is Professor Chartrand still here? One of the things that we talked about in terms of uniting and moving forward is the thing that moves people forward in a united way every time and works every time is a common enemy. And so I'm not saying let's find a common enemy. I'm saying let's find a common good to work towards so that that we can take something that we put our energy into, that we are working towards something together. And my legal training has put me in positions where I have seen on issues that are extremely spiritual, physical, religious, political, like abortion, seeing sort of both sides of the people on those kinds of issues come together and work together on something where it looks like those two groups could never work together. In this room today, we have a lot of common themes coming through, and we're not that far apart in terms of the scale. I think one of the things that I would ask you to think about when we go into the dialogue this afternoon is, how do you wish other people would treat you as a Francophone, as a Métis person? Because the only way to actually implement that and live that is to treat others that way. So we need to come up now with a way to move forward in our relationship where we are treating each other the way we wish others were treating us. And so, no pressure, and trying to have fun. Susan will always have the word fun as her middle name for me because she's the one that said that we better be having fun while we're doing this. So let's have some fun, and let's be respectful of there's just some hard realities of where people come from. You know, my father's a very dark Métis man, and he's still followed around in stores everywhere we go. He's illiterate, he's not institutionally educated. That comes up in his life daily. And so there's lots of examples that we can come up with things like that. He can also do more math in his head than any professor I've ever been around in terms of math because he can't write it down, he has to do it in his head. So there's lots of good things that come out of that. So I think we'd like to turn it back over to the table. We'll use the same format as we did this morning. Have some general comments from the table, go back to the audience so that it's all of you are participating in the discussion. Again, if you're comfortable starting with stories, one of the ways that you understand how to move forward is by coming up with something from your past that has helped you move forward. And I'm going to throw an example out there in case this is something hard to start with. The Machif language is something that we're struggling very hard to maintain and to reinstitute. The French language is institutionalized, and although your struggle is ongoing, you have a solid foundation, legal recognition, constitutional recognition of the language. Now that the French people, and I'm just using Métis as an example, but now that French is an institutionalized, recognized language, you know how important it is. There are youth here that are speaking it. I wish I could speak Métis. I wish so badly I could speak Métis, but I can't. What would you offer in terms of you can support the Métis people in terms of implementing and institutionalizing the Métis language? That's just one small example of where we could go with things this afternoon.
Une réaction? Oui, Susan, go ahead.
One of the things that was mentioned earlier was about children and youth being here. And, there's a number of little kids, and I'm thinking of the next conference. I would really like to see a little bit more more of a structure for the kids and for the youth. I think it's important that they stay and have a chance to visit with elders and to hear the words that we're saying, but also I think it's we need to try a little bit more to get them together. And maybe it would take some leadership from an adult to bring this, to make this happen the next time. Because, I mean, every generation has their obstacles, and I think it was touched upon earlier. And I tend to agree there's differences in experiences, and but it would have been nice if we could maybe do that, facilitate that a little bit more.
Very good point. Who would like to go on? Qui voudrait continuer à parler de son histoire ou d'apporter des idées pour le futur? On est entre les deux, là, vraiment. Monsieur Perret?
J'aimerais bien parler en français, mais vu que ma mère m'a toujours dit s'il y en a un anglais avec vous, parlez le français, parlez en anglais. Ça va se faire tourner en anglais. I'd like to mention a few things. When I started school way back in a little school, we were eight and that started school that same year. I couldn't speak a word of English. Most of them couldn't speak English. But among us, there was one German and one English. We played together as if nothing happened. We were one family. We could understand each other even though we couldn't understand what they were saying. And I think we could bring ourselves back to that level of a family that get along even though we don't understand the language of the next one. I think this is where we should start from. Bring our culture. We have our French culture. You have the Aboriginal culture. If we put these two together, don't we have a culture for the Métis? And if we could prove that point that we have a culture for the Métis, I think we could move along, power together, and be a people that, like, I feel that we're all family here together. Like I was telling someone, I'm sure that more than half my relatives are Métis, you know, and I'm proud of them. We find them in all sorts of life, eh? But we always have quarrels within our family, and this is what we have to try to resolve. So resolve the family. Our quarrel within our family so we can move together.
Merci, Monsieur Perret. Je pense qu'on est en train de... Oui. On est en train de parler de la volonté, hein, de la bonne volonté des gens. Et on a tous ça en nous. Vas-y, Paul.
C'est comment s'entraider. La communauté métisse, la communauté francophone de la Saskatchewan. En situation minoritaire, je suppose, même au Canada, on est voisins d'autres empires anglophones qui est vraiment visé envers la consommation Puis on dirait que la culture, les langues, c'est pas important. On devient comme ça, nous autres ici. Moi, c'est ça que je vois, ça que je me sens. On devient trop américain. Le gros melting pot. Ben, on avait des politiques dans ce pays il n'y a pas très longtemps que, tu sais, on était pour promouvoir le multiculturalisme, le bilinguisme, les langues, les cultures, c'était pour être important, puis je pense qu'on a perdu. On en perd. Alors, moi, ce que j'aimerais voir, ce que je suggère, c'est quand on arrive aux élections, on doit, c'est notre responsabilité de savoir, de connaître les politiques des partis. Les conservateurs, les libéraux, les NPD, etc., les partis verts. Quelles sont leurs politiques envers les cultures, les langues? Parce que je pense qu'on est tous d'accord que quand on perd la langue, c'est le début de la fin. Que ce soit n'importe quelle langue au pays ou culture qu'on aime garder, quand on perd la langue, that's it. Et puis moi, j'aimerais bien voir que, ben, parlons du gouvernement de la Saskatchewan, il devrait avoir le pouvoir, la force de dire aux commissions scolaires, vous n'avez pas le droit de faire ce qu'on a fait dans le Northeast School Division dernièrement, couper des programmes de langue, sans consulter les parents surtout, mais tous les enfants, tous les jeunes de cette province, de cette province devrait avoir le droit d'apprendre une deuxième langue, dans notre cas surtout, on espère, tu sais, le métier, le français. Et puis, comme ça, on pourrait garder la culture qu'on veut garder, que ce soit les métis ou les français. Sans la langue, on est fini. La culture est finie. Alors, chaque fois qu'on a la chance, il faut en discuter avec nos politiciens. Il faut que nos jeunes aient la chance d'apprendre la langue qu'on veut qu'ils apprennent. Tu sais, on est un have province, là. Il n'y a pas d'excuses. Ils ont toujours toutes sortes d'excuses pour couper les programmes. Alors, il faut que nos politiciens sachent que la culture, les arts, les langues sont importantes.
Merci, Paul.
So we've got a couple of themes coming out now. Find some commonalities and work on those. Support each other in ways when we're not together. Find out what election platforms are of people so that if it's something that's supporting the Francophone community, that we support it as well. That if it's something that supports the Métis community, that the Francophone community support it as well. So we're moving along. Those are some good themes to start us, okay? Somebody else at the table would like to participate?
Alors, moi, je voulais juste un peu adresser la question de préserver la langue. Je ne dis pas ça parce que je suis présidente de la JF, je dis ça parce que je crois fermement que la jeunesse tient l'avenir en ses mains. Et puis, je pense que si la communauté métisse a un défi à aller chercher ces jeunes, peut-être de trouver un moyen ou quelque chose qui chapeaute un peu le développement de la jeunesse, un endroit où eux, ils peuvent aller, ils peuvent se diriger pour avoir des conseils, pour apprendre plus sur leur héritage. S'il n'y a pas de documentation disponible pour eux, pour apprendre leur culture et leur héritage, je ne sais pas s'il y a je ne connais pas assez bien les institutions métisses pour savoir qu'est-ce qui existe, là. Mais ce que je suggérerais, ce serait premièrement de créer quelque chose au niveau de la jeunesse pour les aider à s'épanouir puis à se développer en tant que métis et à apprendre leur langue, parce que je trouve que nous, c'est le premier pas qu'on a fait. Je suis la présidente de la JF, je ne me souviens même pas de l'année de création, mais c'est quoi, 76. Alors, c'était un de nos premiers pas dans la fransaskoise pour encourager la jeunesse à s'intéresser à leur langue et à leur culture. Alors, ça, c'est une suggestion que je fais.
Merci, Sophie. Moi, je serais très curieuse à savoir qu'est-ce qui se passe dans la communauté métisse pour les jeunes. Est-ce qu'il y a des je sais que Mme Campbell est partie maintenant, puis elle disait qu'elle allait faire un voyage avec des jeunes pour leur montrer comment la pêche, cueillir des framboises, etc. Non, ce serait en tout cas. à être dans le bois, être dans l'élément. Alors, qui pourrait répondre à ça pour nous, nous aider à mieux comprendre? Est-ce qu'il y a des organisations pour les jeunes métis pour venir renforcer? Est-ce que vous pourriez nous parler de ça? Qu'est-ce qui existe maintenant?
There is Métis youth organizations, and I know that there is some representation in the north. But I was involved in writing a report when I lived in Lorange, and it was the Northern Youth Strategic Action Plan, and many people are working on addressing the needs of the youth and the children today, and some are much more active, and I'll just do the best I can with what I experienced. But it all comes down to certain areas, and that's, you know, access to language in some families. Like, I don't speak Michif, but in Cumberland House they speak Cree, but I don't. I wasn't exposed to that. It's my father lost the language for very significant reasons, and you know, racism and lack of opportunities. And it would be nice to see if we could have access to language classes, and I would like my family to have an opportunity, and like for everyone to have an opportunity to learn more than one language, which would be ideal. But Michif language is important as well as Cree. But we would have to have, because we live in Rostern, how would we do that? Mm-hmm. How could we possibly, it would be difficult. We could have possibly Saturday afternoon classes and certainly make it a priority in the community. But the communities are so diverse and tend to migrate a lot. So it would be, a bit of a challenge. I'm not aware in Rostern if there is any Métis youth organizations or groups, but there is Métis kids. I mean, Duck Lake is not too far, and so for me and my family, that would be the natural next step.
I saw Rita and then Terry.
Well, if I heard correctly, you were asking a question, a specific question about where Marie may possibly head, correct?
Yes. And what is existing at this point?
What is existing with respect to, I think the specific event that Maria is heading to is a group camp that has been organized by the Métis in the northwestern part of Saskatchewan, very much concerned about the well-being of the youth and of course, part of that being what's happening to the culture and the language, but it is more than that. It is also about the kinds of choices that the youth are making in the north. And so, but it is an open youth camp, and we have, there are kids that come from across the province, and likely, in fact, I understand that there are youth that come from out of province as well to that camp, because it's become known.
Yes, I'm the, the president of a charitable organization, the Canadian Métis Heritage Corporation in Melford. And through that particular corporation, we run day programs as well as an alternate school. And we invite all people who may be interested. And so it's just not specific to Métis young people. It also takes in First Nations, non-Métis, non-First Nations youth, and they do things like canoe trips during the summer. They go on some varied day trips to historic sites. They also will do things like enter a float in the parades around to be involved in some sort of constructive activity. And they try to form, I suppose, their identity through activity. And it's one of the small ways we're trying to maintain who we are. They've also have done some live theater productions, which they've offered to the community, which has again brought up their profile within the community. And it has been relatively well received. I say relatively well because it's still in its growing stages, and it is going ahead. So I think there are things that are happening in a number of different communities, it sounds like, which is a really good thing. And I'm glad that this discussion has taken that particular tack, because one of the things that is happening is that we need to see positive strides forward. Thank you.
Merci, Terry. Are we ready to go out?
Anybody else at the table? And then we'll go right out to the audience.
Bon, je pense qu'on peut aller à l'extérieur du cercle et revenir. Ah, Madame Bouvier, vas-y.
Yeah, I was just going to add one more thing because I was responding to your question earlier, but just to reinforce, I think, the point that was made earlier that I think one of the things that we need to do is to be, it seems that we are very clear about what's important to us. That's what I heard this morning. We don't have to repeat that. There's some things that we share that are important to us. We want to maintain our culture and our languages. And it seems, though, that the next step might be, I couldn't help but feel a little bit of jealousy, if I might call it that. But I'm beyond that. You know, I'm a mature, older woman. And I'm not jealous in that sense. When the presentation was made by Joan yesterday, talking about the infrastructure that the Francophone community has, and I think that is part of what our own community has been doing in a global sense as well. And there are pockets in our community which do really wonderful things with youth and working with families in difficulty, that kinds of things. And so it's the institution building that I was wanting to reemphasize. I really think that's what happens when we create institutions and build institutions, such as Gabriel Dumont Institute for us. It carries for us our dreams in many respects, and it's visible to us. And so those are the kinds of things I'd like to see. And I also think there could be opportunities for the very topic we're on now, where there are exchanges, because obviously we need a lot more time than today to share all the stories that we could possibly tell each other. And finally, I guess I would just say that I go back to my own first language and the premise of the identity of the Métis in the northwest part of Saskatchewan is that we are Miwakutuan, which is the sacred act of our relatedness. And it isn't that I am related just in the sense of this person is my uncle or this person is my grandmother, but that we are related in a spiritual sense as human beings. And I think if we remember that, you know, we can transcend many things. And we can support each other in the real political issues that we are contending with, which Paul spoke of, which continue to malign, particularly Indigenous people in this country. Thank you.
Thank you, Rita.
Simone?
I'd just like to further comment on Rita's. It's so funny when in our community we have divisions among the Métis, the Dene people, and the government created those divisions, boundaries. like we're not welcome to attend First Nations gatherings because we're not First Nations. But when there's a crisis in the community, like a death in the community, everyone comes together. We don't see any divisions. Everyone just comes together. And it's so beautiful to see one another getting along. And I felt that today, especially when we put our heads down for a moment. I could feel the spirit, beautiful spirit, and the closeness, and it was so peaceful. In our community, it's hard to find anyone younger than 30 who is able to speak or even understand Métis language. When I moved back to Beauval from Selkirk, when I left Beauval, everyone spoke Cree or Métis. And when I came back in 76, nobody did. Everyone was talking English. And we lost our language. We are losing our language fast. They have a Cree program in the school in Beauval, but it's Cree. Like, I don't understand some of the words my grandchildren come home to say to me, because Cree is different from Métis. I don't know, when you first asked, how do you wish other people would see you as a Métis? Like a normal human being. No, I'm not. I can remember one time we were at Zeller's. I'm not going to say the name of the place, but me and my sister, we kept being followed. Or this intercom would come on, like code one or whatever. So we kept moving away from each other, and we played a trick on this clerk. She was following us. One would go this way and one would go. Sure enough, they had two codes out there. And finally, I said, I'm going to confront her. So I went up to her. Are you following me? Oh, no, ma'am, I'm not. I'm just putting stuff away. I said, I hope not, because I have money to pay for my purchases. Like, just because I have brown skin, I'm not here to steal. So I think that's what we have to teach our children. You know, to be proud and not to be afraid to confront racism. I was going to say more, but I forgot to get it. That's so interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Teach your children, teach your neighbors, teach each other. Live multiculturalism. If that is something that you support politically, then you live multiculturalism. We also heard, actually, youth often come up, right? And one of the things that I love about being at either any First Nations institutional setting or anything that half-breeds or Métis people put on, there's always kids. There's always kids. They're actually supposed to be here listening, learning, and I love that part of my culture. And so the kids should be here, and you're absolutely right. We should have something for them to be understanding on their own. Go to the community that you come from in this province and find out what exists there. I'm hearing that not so much specifically, but what's in your own community? Is there a French person in your community? Find out. How are they functioning there? Is there a Métis person? What are the organizations that are there? Support them. Build them if there aren't any there. Getting to know each other over a cup of coffee, an awful long way to understanding politically who we are, spiritually who we are. What else did I hear? Educate. Educate, especially when there's dissent. Again, Mr. Perret said, you've got to take care of things in your own family. Some things that were raised this morning, what can we do about those to mend those fences and move on? Because everybody does fight. I don't fight with people that I don't know and don't care about. I only fight with people that I care about, right? And so what do we do to mend some of those fences? So some really good ideas coming out of this right now that people are starting to articulate. So maybe we'll move into the audience again and then bring it back to the table. And so, Mrs. Blunt.
Yes, and maybe just to follow up on what you're saying before I go there, je voulais juste qu'on pense aussi, quelles seraient les conditions, les critères, qu'est-ce que ça prendrait, comme tu as dit, Marilyn, pour se rencontrer comme voisins? Est-ce quelque chose qui manque? J'aimerais qu'on réfléchisse là-dessus, puis ce serait le fun de voir où est-ce qu'on peut aller avec ça. Alors, quels seraient les critères, les conditions, qui seraient positives pour faire avancer notre relation? Maintenant, je vais aller voir Mme Perry Bonondo.
OK. I'm about to address you again. First, I know some of the things you talk about are probably necessary, but I think the basic help we need probably is to support our land claim issues. Land claim is important because I think it is important to our economy. And as long as the Métis people are at the very bottom of the barrel in the economic picture of this province and this country, I think we are going to be probably non-participating in our own country. We hear a lot of support for other countries over our radio station, CBC. But we, as far as I remember, I don't remember hearing CBC ever supporting the Métis cause for land in their own land. And I think that's one of our most basic, our most important needs, is that we settle the land claim issue, which I'm sure will inspire a good economic background for all our children. Thank you.
Darren?
I just wanted to add, I don't want to age myself, but about 10 or 11 years ago, I went to Quebec for a program for Francophone or Quebec. Simone Papé était Canadien français, parce que ça, I had 6 free weeks of holidays in Quebec. And what's really interesting is that's something that could be replicated because there are people in the communities. Couldn't we lobby? I don't know how realistic, but there's a network. I've worked at GDI for 10 years, and I deal with people in Canadian Heritage, and the people running Canadian Heritage are Francophones. Like, that's a portfolio that's given to Quebecois almost always, and from the line down, they're almost all Francophones. Is there a way that we can lobby to have similar programs, intensive programs, for people to go to communities like Saint Laurent, Manitoba, where they speak the language, or Delacrosse, and pattern it on this Francophone or Quebec with Métis, you know, sensitivities, and use the same system and gradually work to try to make our Indigenous languages on the same status as French and English as official languages, and lobby that and use that pattern, because I could tell you the Aboriginal Languages Initiative, the Métis in Saskatchewan get $125,000 to preserve their language. We have to divide it between all the Michif languages. There's 3 that we work with. We haven't done anything with Dene. They speak Dene and Lalash. We haven't done anything in Cumberland House. They speak Swampy Cree. So that's not a lot of money for 40 to 80,000 people. So is there a way we can lobby to get into that network, you know, to make like a long-term Métis bursary program as well? because the language retention rates and assimilation rates for the Métis are probably 90-95%. They're not the 40 or 50% for Francophone or Quebec, you know. So that was just an idea. Maybe we can all collectively work on that. Merci.
Sophie?
Yeah, I just wanted to respond to Darren's comments. I think it's definitely possible. And I think that, I mean, obviously I'm sure I'm not teaching you anything when I say that if you have the time or the energy to go through the 3,000 grants on the federal government's little CD, there's thousands and thousands of dollars available for stuff just like that. It's just learning to meet the right people and to apply for those grants. And I think over the years, Francophones have become, a lot of us anyways, experts at spinning a web to get money. So, I mean, I think that whoever is interested, come and talk to me. I know a lot of people. Come talk to Pauline. He knows a lot of people. Talk to Denis Degagné, who's sitting over there. He knows a lot of people. I mean, actually, one of the ladies who works for Heritage Canada is here today. Frédéric Baudemont's in the back, if you want to go talk to her. You know, she's a program agent. Program officer for Heritage Canada. She gives out money. So go talk to her. I mean, yeah, because $125,000, I'm a little outraged. I mean, I work for an association that has 100 members, and that's our annual budget. So I'm a little ashamed now to share that with you. But definitely, I think if that's something that you guys are having a hard time with, and obviously we've learned through the years how to do it. So just as I'm sure, I don't know what questions we have or what we need help in, but you guys definitely have your own expertise. Mm-hmm. Not saying that we're here to teach you, I'm just saying that if you have questions, we know stuff, so you can ask if you're going to.
Oui, c'est un partage de connaissances, hein, finalement. Un partage. Paul-Émile, tu veux dire quelque chose? Après ça, j'ai deux autres personnes. Vas-y.
Well, just quickly on that same vein, we get a couple million, you know, and it seems like a lot of money for associations, but how much do we need to counterbalance the billions of dollars that the English media in North America, you know, going back to the United States again, but we've been getting assimilated so quickly from their influence with movies and the games that kids play. And when I hear the kids up north a couple of years ago, a revelation that the young Cree kids up north are losing their language as fast as anybody else because of satellite dish TV, radio, music. It's unbelievable. That's why everybody has to join together to do it, whatever, to lobby our politicians. We need more and more money to keep our, you know, Canadian heritage, culture, Métis, French, everything. Otherwise, we're just going to become one big North American melting pot. And so you need a lot of money to balance that media.
Merci, Paul. François, and then Rita, and then Joanne.
J'aime entendre ce qui se dit en dessous de la table, comme cela. Mais je voulais juste revenir à quelque chose que je crois que Terry avait mentionné tantôt à propos qu'il faisait des voyages de canots, etc. Mais je crois qu'une grosse partie d'essayer de récupérer la culture, et ça serait comme de faire ces voyages en canot-là avec des moniteurs qui parlent de Métis. Et de cette façon-là, parce que si vous le faites juste en anglais, vous contribuez à votre propre assimilation, en quelque sorte. Et je sais que c'est la même chose pour les Canadiens français. On a des camps de jeunesse, mais les camps de jeunesse, ça se passe en français. C'est pas... Alors, il faut faire attention. C'est beau demander du financement, mais il faut être intelligent avec la façon qu'on l'utilise. Et je crois que c'est la façon aussi de récupérer notre indépendance et interdépendance, en quelque sorte, si je peux la mettre de main. Parce que si on devient maître de sa propre culture, en quelque sorte, il n'y a personne d'autre qui peut venir s'ingérer pour nous dire quoi faire. Et tant qu'on adopte toujours la langue du pouvoir, on est toujours assujetti à leur pouvoir. Je ne sais pas si je me fais comprendre.
Merci beaucoup. Rita?
I guess as a Métis woman with children, we've been studied to death. We've attended roundtables on numerous occasions, and it feels like we're spinning our wheels because we never get anywhere as a nation, as a community. And I guess what I'm looking for here is some sort of guarantee that some of the discussion and some of the recommendations that are coming from these roundtables will be taken somewhere. I guess my first recommendation as you know, a Métis woman, would be that we partner with the French community in regards to them bringing us along, because we're playing catch up right now, not only with the French, but with the First Nations. And so what I would hope is that part of the partnership be that the French would be willing to share some of the models that they have used in the past to bring them to where they are today, to help us as a nation of people to start developing language programs, to start developing our own education system, because that's the only way that we as a nation are going to retain our culture, our heritage, and be able to pass it on efficiently and effectively to our youth. And when you look at the situation with the Aboriginal youth across Canada, I think it's important that we start reaching those youth now. I think one of the main problems with our youth is identity, and that's been mentioned around the table a number of times. And I think one of the things that we can get rolling here to partner with our French brothers and sisters is to start using their models and start moving our culture and our heritage forward.
Merci beaucoup, Rita. Joanne, and after Barb and Denis. Okay, je m'en viens.
Francine a posé la question, qu'est-ce que ça va prendre pour qu'on puisse travailler ensemble? On a parlé de volonté, on a parlé de respect. Mais je pense, plus important, il faut qu'on se fasse confiance. We have to trust each other. Si moi, je veux travailler, me rapprocher avec la communauté métisse, c'est parce que je veux apprendre. Je veux m'améliorer comme personne. Je veux devenir meilleure citoyenne. Je veux mieux connaître mes voisins. Alors, l'aspect de l'histoire, l'aspect de confiance est très important aussi. Deuxième chose, je pense, hier puis aujourd'hui, on a beaucoup parlé d'histoire, notre histoire. Et si je suis francophone aujourd'hui, c'est à cause de mon histoire. Comme vous l'avez dit ce matin, les Métis, votre environnement, votre passé, vos prédécesseurs vous ont fait qui vous êtes aujourd'hui. Alors, notre histoire doit demeurer vivante, mais ne doit pas nous, je veux dire, contrôler, limiter. Si on demeure dans le passé, on pourrait faire ça comme francophones, dire, bien, on a toujours été victimisés, là, puis merde, je le prends plus, là, mais je pense qu'une partie de notre progrès, c'est qu'on s'est, comme François l'a dit ce matin, je pense qu'on est citoyen du Canada, on a des droits, tout le monde, tous les citoyens du Canada ont des droits, et on a, en prenant l'approche que, comme citoyen, je demande seulement à quoi j'ai droit. Je demande pas l'océan, là, j'ai des droits. Dernier commentaire que je veux faire. Quand j'entends des histoires comme Simone a dit, qu'elle se fait suivre dans un magasin, j'ai honte de faire partie d'une société qui... Alors, je m'excuse pour tous ces...
Merci, Joanne. Barbara?
La prochaine fois, je ne suis pas quelqu'un qui pleure. Parce que je vais pleurer tout avec toi. Joanne, en fait, je m'excuse. J'ai tellement de pensées depuis que je suis ici que je risque de devenir un rambling Barbara. Fait que je vais essayer de viser juste une, mais avec des petits extras. Mais Joanne, quand elle dit, puis quand on parle de citoyenneté, ceux avec qui j'ai parlé en fin de semaine, vous savez bien que je peux faire mon cheminement dans une des deux langues, mais quand je choisis de parler en français, quand je choisis de faire partie de l'équipe fransaskoise, comme je le dis, c'est parce que c'est un acte de citoyenneté. Je suis une bonne Canadienne aujourd'hui parce que I can do it in both languages and I'm so proud of that. Et j'apprécie tellement que je puisse faire ça. Mais madame qui a parlé à propos d'être maman, et moi aussi je suis maman, et quand on est maman, on se parle de, tu sais, des choses qui nous sont très importantes. Puis te demander des garanties, il n'y a rien que je peux te garantir. Mais moi, le domaine dans lequel je circule et je voyage, c'est le domaine de l'éducation. Et puis, une des grosses lacunes que je perçois dans notre éducation, c'est justement la sensibilisation, l'apprentissage. L'historique des Métis, moi, je ne l'ai pas appris quand j'étais jeune, puis mon enfant, il n'en apprend pas plus. Ça n'existe pas. Et surtout dans les écoles francophones et dans les systèmes d'immersion où les jeunes sont là puis qui apprennent les cours de sciences sociales, Adèle le disait aujourd'hui, sa quatrième année, 7, 8, puis 12e. Mais est-ce que c'est vraiment un apprentissage ou c'est juste, ah oh oui, ils sont là, ah oh oui, ça existe? Comment ça se fait que les travaux de Mme Campbell, c'est pas la lecture obligatoire pour les jeunes de la Saskatchewan? Pourquoi est-ce que l'historique des Premières Nations, des traités, c'est pas obligatoire? Et quand nous, la communauté francophone, on veut avancer l'idée que de l'importance d'une deuxième langue, puis qu'on travaille avec nos partenaires, de l'importance des lois pour obliger que les jeunes qui finissent en Saskatchewan, finissant de secondaire, aient deux langues ou l'apprentissage en deux langues, qu'on parle aussi de la qualité de cet apprentissage-là et du contenu de cet apprentissage-là. Que les jeunes n'apprennent pas juste la bonne conjugaison, masculin, féminin, toutes les choses qu'on connaît bien en français, mais aussi qu'ils apprennent leur historique et l'historique de leurs partenaires, leur famille, leurs cousins, dont notre famille, notre grande famille de la Saskatchewan. Alors, pour ceux qui ont le pouvoir politique, et puis il paraît que j'ai un petit rôle à jouer là-dedans aussi, c'est une des idées que j'essaie d'avancer quand j'ai la chance de le faire, mais j'espère que les autres vont se joindre à moi puis vont tenir ma main quand j'essaie d'en parler. Et en tout cas, je deviens Ramblin' Barb, fait que je te cède la parole. Merci.
Merci, Barb. Denis?
Tout simplement, depuis tantôt, on parle beaucoup d'argent, de langue. On vient d'une culture où on parlait souvent de qui perd sa langue perd sa foi. On parle de l'exemple de la communauté francophone pour bâtir des liens ou en tout cas faire des ponts avec la communauté métisse. Mais je pense que nous, les francophones, on a énormément à apprendre de ce que vous vivez, vous, communauté métisse. Puis l'élément essentiel, qui perd sa langue, perd sa foi, c'est faux, parce que vous êtes là, vous êtes la preuve de ça. Et je pense que ce qu'on a à aller chercher de ce que vous avez dans cet échange-là, c'est votre côté spirituel qui tient tout ça ensemble. Et c'est ça la grande apprentissage que nous, on a à faire. Donc, il faut que ça soit un échange.
Hello, Harriet Oaks, this Nickerson. I was so fascinated by the Francophone language. Well, I love all types of languages. And I joined in with a crowd last night and sat with them, and they were having so much fun in their language. It made me so envious. I was just hoping that I could speak that language too. But I want to give you just a sample of the way my language sounds. It doesn't sound like any one of your languages over here. I'll speak about my growing up days back home. Tenigi kiti makshinan, jis les enfants yuch gitashinan, wit les filles, deux les garçons. Tenimana Les Suisses, les lièvres, les poissons, les chevreux. But mungi kashki ta nan yin nan chimachi ah chini pahaya hok li chevreux. Yen kli chavaj. But gimesh kuto ni ka nan mana. Ni mama gro jardin ki yao. Li patak mana mishtahigi kishchikeo. And sak di patak mana gimi ananik li chavaj. Por peyak e shovrugi pe tamaka winan. Ikshipiku maneki ship machiak. And who understood any bit of what I had to say? Yeah. Any of the Francophone? I have to poo. But you understood every word. That's good. Yeah. Well, I just thought I'd share this with you, my language, because I felt out of place listening to all of you talk, and I thought, where am I from? I thought I was from space or something, because my language is so different from yours. But anyway, like, another thing I would like to ask is, I know some Métis organizations, just small little organizations, like from Yorkton, from Saskatoon, who are very much struggling. They try to do funding. They can't get any money from the government for even a hall or anything, so that they have to use personal homes, and every second Sunday they play a game called Baroche, and they pay $5 to enter in, and the winner gets $5, and the second place winner gets $2, and the rest is kept by one individual in the community, and they use this money when one of the Métis people is sick in the hospital, depending how sick they are. If they're really, really sick, then they take them flowers. If they're not too, too sick, then they take them a basket of fruit. And they've tried so hard to do a little schooling of Michif, teaching Michif, but they just can't get a hall. They try to do meetings, and all they do is fight. They argue with one another so much. They're so much envious. Like the head person is called down because he thinks he knows too much, or she thinks she knows too much. And it's so disorganized. It's just a pity to see something like that. It really is. And how I wish that you could share something with me that I could maybe help out there. Example is, what kind of functions do you do to make money for your organizations? And how often do you meet the meetings that you have? And how do you organize your executive member, like the president, the secretary, and so forth? All those things I would really like to learn from the Francophone. So maybe I can somehow help out my kind of people, my Michifs down here. So, well, those was what, seeing as how we're here, two communities trying to combine and help out each other, this is the questions I had for you. But I could tell you stories in my Michif language, because I'm recognized as a storyteller throughout all the schools in Saskatoon. So, we're not here to listen to my stories, and we're running out of time anyway. So hope you enjoyed my language as much as I enjoy yours. Thank you. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. Oui. Est-ce qu'il y a quelqu'un qui aimerait répondre directement à Mme Oakes ou est-ce quelque chose qu'on va... Monsieur Perret, oui.
Merci. Merci beaucoup. I enjoy all languages too because around St. Louis we have the Norwegians, we have Germans. And my daughter would go out for Stax Canada. And you come to a place where there was little fellas this tall and they talk in Norwegian. And she said, it's so beautiful, I can't understand them, but it's so beautiful that they do talk in another. I have a grand, great-grandson that's only 3 years old. If I speak to him in French, he answers in French. If I speak to him in English, he answers in English. You know, I'm so proud that he can do both languages. But my main topic right now is we were talking about money. Have you thought of having a community school? You know, in St. Louis, we became a community school. With a community school, you have other funds. And since in St. Louis, we have a great majority of Métis, we've been able to bring in a lot of speakers that show the tradition and culture of the Métis to our students, which they enjoy immensely. We even brought in artists and that. And that all comes through the fact that we are a community school now.
Merci, Monsieur Perret. Oui, Scott.
Okay. Also, I can't remember your name.
Madame Oakes.
Madame Oakes. Okay. You were talking about how groups can make money. One way that a lot of groups that I've worked with make a lot of money is by working bingos and just selling the cards. You can make a lot of money doing that if you get involved with, just talk with the bingo hall, ask how you can put in a group to be able to work bingos once or twice a month. It's not a lot of work, but you make quite a bit of money. Also, like Sophie was saying before, there's a lot of government grants that you can apply for. You just have to be able to find them. Probably if you phone some of the PA locals, they might be able to help you out because I know they do apply for lots of grants and things like that. I don't know how many they get, but they do apply for a lot of them. But those are really easy ways of making money, applying for grants and working bingos. And also you're talking about a hall that you guys would need instead of using people's houses. Go talk with schools. There's so many schools in Saskatoon and like especially the elementary schools that don't have their gyms booked 24/7. They are usually more than happy to lend you the gym. That's what I find anyway in PA. I can go talk with any of the elementary schools and say, well, you know, we want to have a meeting. We don't really have anywhere to have it. Would we be able to use your gym from 7 to 9 on Tuesday? And 90% of the time it's okay. So that's something where you don't have to spend a lot of money to get a hall. You can actually use it for free. Like, I know money is a big issue, but there's always ways around money. People are always looking to help out other people, even though we think everyone's just looking out for themselves. Inside, everybody's a good person, I think. And if you appeal to them in a nice way and you're doing it for a good cause, they'll usually help you out. Okay? So, I don't know.
Merci, Scott. Sophie?
Sorry, I don't mean to manipulate. Other quick suggestion for Madame Oakes. You should try the Francophone Community Center in Saskatoon. Usually we'd make a special deal or hand it out for free for people in our community. But I'm sure if they know that you're a nonprofit organization, they won't charge. And it's downtown. It's not a gym, but it's a hall. So if that's another suggestion for you, if you need the phone number or anything, just come talk to me.
Merci, Sophie. Ce serait bien d'entendre les autres participants autour de la table. Est-ce que Adèle, tu es en train de faire oui? Est-ce que tu es prêt à dire quelque chose? T'absorbes. C'est beaucoup de choses à absorber, c'est sûr et certain. Oui, Lucille.
On a eu une discussion avec les dames de l'autre côté. Cet après-midi. Et puis, il y en avait une qui avait mentionné que peut-être on pourrait, comme les deux, le français, les métis, se rencontrer ici encore une autre fois, pas juste pour une table ronde, mais allons dire que on fait du manger que le monde aime tellement, on se rencontre et puis on a tout chacun nos manières à faire les choses. Et puis apporter de l'art et les choses qu'on fait chez nous, avoir les enfants alentour et comme avoir un spectacle. Mm-hmm. Viser vers ça pour être ensemble.
Oui, c'est bon ça.
That's a great idea.
Être ensemble, c'est ça qui compte. Puis je pense que quand on est ensemble, on va pouvoir justement trouver des solutions. Puis quand on parle de garantie, bien, je pense qu'on le garantie, c'est en étant autour de la table et en travaillant ensemble. Le résultat, on n'est pas sûr qu'est-ce que ça va donner, mais si en mettant notre volonté. Puis j'espère par la fin de la journée qu'il va y avoir des idées, juste comment on continue, que ce soit continuer à se connaître, à échanger de la nourriture et ça, mais aussi continuer à le dialogue pour des choses concrètes. Peut-être un projet comme tel, ça serait très intéressant de voir où que ça peut aller. Est-ce qu'autour de la table, il y a d'autres personnes qui aimeraient, avant de retourner dans l'audience? Scott? Vas-y.
I think he doesn't like me anymore. Talking about guarantees and stuff, I think one thing that came up that could be really easily guaranteed for next year is what Susan said first about how we should have things going on for children, because that would be the easiest thing to guarantee. For Rita mm-hmm. up there, I remember her mm-hmm. saying that she wanted some guarantees out of this, and that's one very simple thing to guarantee. You know, having some games and things like that going on for children to have fun being here. Mm-hmm. Because if they come here 1 year and they have a good time playing games out in the field with a bunch of people, they're going to want to come back next year. And then as they get older, they'll remember, oh, that's right, I had so much fun as a kid. I'll bring my kids. And then we'll have more than 50 people here. You know, I think that's something that's really easy to do. So people that kind of organize this stuff, to get free volunteers, phone the PA or the Saskatoon Playground Program, phone the College of Education in Saskatoon, phone either SunTeps. These are people that are always looking for volunteer things to do to be able to put on their resume so it looks good. You know? Mm-hmm. So... That's just an idea.
Merci. Susan.
Sorry, I shut you off.
I like the idea of having activities for kids, but it would be really nice to see even more, like enhanced programming, to come up with a bar set. We want to have storytellers, we want to have elders telling stories, we want to hear the language, we want to hear this, we want to give this opportunity for our children. And to have, you know, a certain amount of I don't know, traditional games or activities with floral beadwork to share some of the traditional arts with the community would be ideal. And as well, it'd be wonderful if we could start to plan to transfer those skills and to share them as well.
Merci, Susan.
One of the things that's been mentioned to me a few times, actually, over the last couple of days is something that maybe was missing that we would do if it was a Métis cultural event and we were inviting the Francophone community to our event. There are protocols that we would follow, and there would have been a lot more ceremony at the beginning, and because this is Métis land, and land is such a central crucial issue, and land has a spiritual component as well that we often don't talk about in our political back and forth, but that we would have had a welcome, a formal welcome in a ceremonial sense for you. And so I would love to participate in something where the Métis community is inviting the Francophone community to come back, and we will greet you with the proper protocol that we know that we need to obey in our communities, and you will see how rich that is and where we come from. Masters of our own culture is something that was said by Paul-Émile earlier, and I think that when you take it over and you're looking after it yourself, other people don't come in and try to look after it for you. I think that's very crucial. Something that I just want to put out there for the organizers, as I'm listening to how are we going to move forward on this, what are we going to use in terms of activities to keep in touch with each other, how do we find each other again, those kinds of things, perhaps the University of Regina could take a role in developing some kind of a web page where events can be posted provincially, and this could get big, and I'm sure not trying to put something on the shoulders of the University of Regina exclusively, but we need a mechanism to keep in touch with each other and to continue this conversation, because you're going to be right. We're all just going to go home and say, oh, that was cold. It was good. We talked to a lot of people. Remember that cold day we got together? So we don't want that to happen. So how do we get some momentum out of this? So some really good ideas coming out of that. One thing that I'm going to add as a mother who's homeschooled, and I have children in university now and have a three-year-old, education, whether it's institutional or not, is crucial. And I would invite us as a Métis community to take some responsibility about creating something to present in the French schools for education on Métis. I think that's an easy thing to do that we can all participate in. And I just want to add my 2 cents. I got told not to do that, so I'll get my hand slapped later, but there's my 2 cents, okay?
C'est beau ça. Merci. Adèle?
You just mentioned education, which is exactly what I was thinking at that point. We don't learn enough about Métis history in school. Going to school in French, of course, we learn a lot of the French history. You learn about les colons qui viennent de l'Europe, which is all well and good. That is part of our history, but there's a whole other side of that that we're missing. And I really felt that when I went away to university this year. I took up a Native Studies class, and it was one of the best classes I had all year, because you get all of this extra stuff that, even as it's my own history, I don't know it. That, to me, is one of the most important things that we should be working on, is getting more of that Métis and First Nations history put into the schools, because there's not enough of it. And along with the education, the history ties into culture and, of course, language. Harriet Oakes was speaking in Machif, and I was just entranced. I wanted to hear more. And I was inquiring today about wanting to learn to speak Machif. Now, right now, at this very moment, that's like top of my priority list. That's the next thing I want to learn. And for us, French is an official language, so we have that option. And I think speaking Machif should be an option that everybody has as well.
Whew. Merci. Vous savez, le temps passe très vite, hein, quand on jase autour d'une table. Ça ne me surprend pas du tout. Puis, malheureusement, je sais qu'il y a des gens qui auraient beaucoup falloir terminer, hein? Mais c'est bon signe. Moi, je prends ça. Je suis toujours l'optimiste. Puis j'essaie toujours de voir le bon côté des choses. Ça veut dire qu'il y a des questions, il y a des réponses, et ça va nous donner une autre occasion pour se rencontrer, mais pour continuer le dialogue. Et sûrement, les gens qui ont ceux qui prennent des décisions, qui sont ici, ont entendu les souhaits, les rêves, les demandes, et on va sûrement pouvoir vous rapporter quelque chose. Donc, je pense avec ça, Marilyn, on devrait... est-ce que tu veux avoir le dernier mot? Je sais que t'as pris 2 minutes, mais c'est beau, tu peux aller. Moi, je vous remercie beaucoup, beaucoup. Ça a été un grand plaisir de faire partie de ce moment historique. Je ne peux pas voir, même si j'ai commencé une nouvelle mode, mais peut-être que non, hein? Oui, tout le monde avait des couvertes, c'est bien. Il manquait juste le feu. En tout cas, merci beaucoup. Vas-y, Marilyn.
I would like to thank all of the participants here, the ones who are at the table and the ones who are seated in various places and are warming up outside. This has been an absolute honor to sit and listen and to participate in something that that is so historical. You could feel sitting in this room that one day we're going to say, do you know how all that got started? It got started at that damn cold Batoche day when we were all sitting around in blankets. That's what we're going to talk about. There's footage of that. I'll show you. We were frozen. And it's going to be wonderful. I'm very, very pleased to participate in that. One of the things that when we were working on the Métis election issue in Saskatchewan, one of the things that we saw clearly that was missing was an education piece. And one of the other people that was working with us was an ex-RCMP officer. And I just want to sort of tie my story in with what I've been hearing over the afternoon. How do we work with youth? We tell ourselves all the time that the youth are the leaders of our future. And I don't know about the rest of you, but it takes a blink of an eye for 5 years to go by in my life right now. And within a blink of an eye, the little people who are wandering about in the background, they're going to be making decisions about us. And in Saskatchewan, this is an interesting story. In Saskatchewan, we have one of the best records for seatbelt safety. Did you know that? Saskatchewan should be very proud of our record for seatbelt safety. Do you know why? Do you know why that? Because they went into the schools and they educated the kids. Because they knew the kids were going to go home and they were going to tell their parents. And their parents were going to say, where did you learn that? And how come the seatbelts are under the seat, Dad? Did you know we were supposed to be wearing those? And as a result of that, don't drink and drive and the seatbelt safety thing was targeted at youth in Saskatchewan and it has had the most success. So when we take action in our schools and educate our youth about our history, which we don't know where you're going unless you know where you've come from, it re-implement our language. I just want to just honor everybody at the table for being brave enough to put all the stuff that's hard to talk about. I think perhaps I'm hearing for the Francophone community that there are some harsh realities in the Métis community that maybe you haven't been exposed to in the past that are absolutely alive and well. Including our passion and our love for our culture and the fight for our future and who we are. So again, thank you so much for allowing me to participate. It was truly an honor for me.